And you owe me all!
And welcome back to Mindbreakers. We got a special one for you today.
Yes.
From 1986, Manhunter.
And God, I've been waiting so long, dude.
And so have I.
No, especially that intro, man. Just for that intro. Because, like, my God, I love that line. That whole little monologue he does. I love it.
Former FBI profiler Will Graham returns to service to pursue a deranged serial killer, dubbed the Tooth Fairy by the media. Now, yes. This movie is based on a book.
Yeah,
the name Manhunter. No. This is instead based on Thomas Harris's 1981 novel, Red Dragon.
Mm-hmm.
This movie is also... It was, like, the reason it's not called Red Dragon is this is before... Like, at this point, Thomas Harris had, like, two novels out.
It was Hannibal and Hannibal Rising, right?
No. Hannibal Rising came out in 2007.
Yeah, that's true. He wrote that after.
Way after. But at this point, the only books he had out were Red Dragon and Black Sunday, which was some, like, blimp terrorist thing.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah, I forgot about
Silence of the Lambs. Was not written until 1988, which was 2 years after this film. So this is before Lecter was big or important or anyone really cared.
Mm-hmm.
Like this is early, early, early. Because if Silence of the Lambs was out, because Silence of the Lambs is, I've read the books, I've seen the movie. It's the best one. It is just by far the best one.
Yeah, and he wrote Hannibal and then Hannibal Rising, right?
Yeah, Hannibal, he wrote in 1999, Hannibal Rising in 2005-2007.
Yeah, okay.
I think that, like, the shortest turnover between book and movie was Hannibal Rising, because it was already, he was basically a money print a press at that time, but only very kinda briefly. Briefly.
Yeah, but this is abruptly Red Dragon. And honestly, doesn't even really have a whole lot to do with Hannibal.
No,
honestly, Lecter is not really.
To be fair, in the novel Red Dragon, it has very little to do with Hannibal. He's from a former case that Will Graham worked on. He's already in the Baltimore State Hospital for the medically insane. He's done. He's out of the way.
Yeah, he got his for now.
Perhaps you'd like to leave me a home phone number.
Yeah,
this is also pre-Hopkins. We have instead Brian Cox,
who does very, very well, honestly.
Who you may remember as William Stryker from X-Men 2.
Mm-hmm. He does a bang of job, honestly, as the doctor, as the bad doctor.
And one, because
we can't call him good doctor, can we?
Oh no. Well, I'm sure he was good as a psychiatrist with the people he didn't eat.
Oh, yeah, of course. He was able to analyze the hell out of people, which is why he was so good in his other job, which was his night job, which was, murder. You know, murdering and eating people.
He liked to do the murders.
Mm-hmm.
Now,
that he did.
I'm reading Red Dragon at the moment. I will not let the book knowledge affect the movie, except for a few things, because we're not reviewing it as an adaptation, we're reviewing it as a movie.
Yeah, as a film.
Suffice to say, it does do better in both departments than The Dark Tower did.
Yeah, and honestly, I'm reading Hannibal Rising right now. I've got my copy right over here, and I've also got Hannibal in general, just regular Hannibal over here too.
I'm suddenly afraid. My copy of Red Dragon legit just fell off my bookshelf.
When I was actually reviewing these, I had my copies of Hannibal Rising and Hannibal and the corner of my drawing board, and the second I went to play, like, freaking Manhunter, literally my books fell off, and I was like, oh... So I think whatever spirit's haunting you is haunting me, too.
It also has William Peterson as Paul Graham, who's been in basically nothing I know about.
Yeah, honestly, they are, for the most part, like,
he produced
unknown actors.
Well, this is a low budget. It's really good, but it's a low budget film.
Mm-hmm. Honestly, this was somebody's passion project. Mm. They were just like, okay, I really want to make an adaptation of this.
Because
honestly, it was good.
It's before both the book Silence of the Lambs and then the film Silence of the Lambs.
Right.
Really, really put Hannibal Lecter on the map.
Uh-huh. And it does have two well-known actors, though, in it.
Yeah, Brian Cox and Tom Noonan.
Tom Noonan is the cop, right?
No, Tom Noonan is the Tooth Fairy.
Oh, yeah, right.
He's the Whitey Boy.
I'm also thinking of two other actors that are in this.
Who?
This was a Dino De Laurentiis film, by the way.
Yeah.
And... who are the two I'm thinking of?
Stephen Lang.
Possibly Stephen Lang, yeah.
Oh, wow, he was in the Stupid Blue movie.
The Stupid Blue movie?
Yeah. You know, the gritty reboot of Pocahontas in space.
Hmm, oh, yeah.
Oh, and he was in Tombstone, as Ike Canton. Clanton.
I'm thinking of Dennis Farina.
Never heard of that person before. But he plays, I know who he plays. He plays,
He's
Jack.
Yeah, exactly. He's Jack. He's in a bunch of movies, honestly. He's in, Snatch.
Mm-hmm. Midnight Run.
Great film.
Get Shorty.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Law and Order.
But I mostly know him from Snatch. I mostly know him in that one. I forget who he plays in that, but, He plays a really good character in that one. I think he's like a lawyer or something for the jeweler guy, the Jewish jeweler guy in that.
Hmm. He also plays Wildcat in Justice League Unlimited.
Right. Also, one other actor that I kind of forgot.
Get to talking about the movie?
Yeah, exactly. Before we get into this, I'm just going to name drop one more here, provided I can find it. Da-da-da. Because I have him in my notes here. Where is it? Shit. I have it here. I know I have it.
Is it Benjamin Hendrickson?
Bear with me. No, it's not Benjamin.
Kim Grice.
No, I have it over here. Frank Faucian. Faucian. Frank Faucian.
I can't even see him on the cast list I have right in front of me here. I have to go to see full cast, even see the guy.
He's Lieutenant Fisk, the black cop from Die Hard.
I don't even remember him being in the movie.
He's there.
Huh, all right.
Frank Faucian. The one that was on the radio with one Bruce Willis.
Oh yeah.
The one that shot that kid.
Yeah, the kid who was confirmed to be Urkel.
Yes.
Oh, he was in Coming to America.
Yeah, he was in that too.
I'm sorry, why on the four known fours that he's in, does it show Coming to America, Do the Right mm-hmm. Thing, White Chicks, and the Thomas Crown Affair, but not Die Hard?
Honestly, I don't know.
Like, I get, yeah, Coming to America, sure, but shouldn't White Chicks be anything else?
Honestly, I feel like it probably might be going for like the most chronological, like the most recent it's possible.
Yeah, the most recent.
As opposed to chronological, sorry.
The most recent, 1988, 1989, 1999, 2004.
Well, what else has he been in?
Blacklist, TV series, Grey's Anatomy, I'm Your Woman, Killing of Kenneth Chamberlain, God Friended Me.
Whatever. Okay, honestly, I can agree with maybe three of those being major, one of those maybe being a major role. The other three are like probably minor.
The 2020 the version of The Grudge.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen any version of The Grudge.
I've seen the original and also recent one.
He was on Luke Cage.
Yeah, I think he was in Luke Cage also.
Yeah, he was Pop Hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway,
I also it's been so long since I've seen Luke Cage. So let's watch it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
intruder entered through kitchen sliding door.
Nationwide victims.
Yeah, this is Will Graham of the FBI.
One killer.
This is what the subject's teeth look like.
Titles in green, do you see?
Do you see?
Do you see?
I see! this fishnet stalking over my head, do you see?
We start with a point of view shot and upstairs in a stuffed penguin, do you see?
Yes, I see!
We
have flashlights on staircases, do you see?
Woman wakes up in bed to see intruder, do you see?
Yes, I see.
And Will Graham's on a beach talking to Jack Crawford. And it's like, hey, I need you to do a thing for me. I told you, I don't do that kind of thing anymore. But I have a new case for you. No. Come on, it's a murderer, though. Fine.
Get out.
It is the cliches.
Christ.
But yeah, there's a murderer called the Tooth Fairy.
Yeah, this guy Will, he is I like to refer to him kind of as the baby hunter.
Mm.
As opposed to the manhunter.
Why?
Because he's hunting the Tooth Fairy, and the Tooth Fairy is kind of a baby.
In some ways, I guess.
He kind of goes full baby mode in certain parts, honestly. Like, he's like, we're going to call him the Tooth Fairy. Like, all the cops and everything, they're like, yeah, his nickname's the Tooth Fairy. Everybody okay with this? Yeah, cool. Even though we get a chuckle out of it. Huh. All right. What does the killer himself actually think of this? I want to be called the Red Dragon!
Yeah, maybe you should really put some kind of calling card if you want to be known as the name you want to be known as.
Yeah, but he has, like, very little, individuality, aside from maybe the fact that he bites his victims.
Yeah. But, yeah, he's killed two families and their kids. Two whole families he's murdered at this point. Bite marks on the body. He's like, I don't want to go. It's like, come on, we need you. You're good at this, though. It's like, but... You caught Lecter. Yeah, but he cut my chest open with a linoleum knife.
Another reason why I call him Baby Hunter is because he's also kind of reluctant about doing this again.
It's interesting, though.
Mm-hmm.
Because his wife, Molly, talks to Jack, and usually in this type of movie, the wife's like, how dare you? You promised me you wouldn't do this thing, but she's not... She's not pissed at her husband. Mm-hmm.
You're putting the case before your family.
But she's not pissed at her husband about that. She's pissed at the boss. It's like, you...
Yeah, exactly.
You know he shouldn't be doing this. Why...
Yeah, you're dragging him into this again. Fuck you. Like, honestly, I agree with her, though.
Though it always bugs me in movies and shows where, like, oh, you care more about your job than me, and it's a job that's literally life and death.
Yeah, it's got a lot of stakes to it. Mm. And he's totally like down for it, but at the same time his wife is like, you're dragging him into this, like that's stupid. Honestly, he wants to get as far away from this as possible for the sake of us, you know.
So he agrees to do the case, but first he and his son put a fence around some baby turtles. Mm-hmm. This is not important. But the movie spends so much time on this scene.
Well, like, it's kind of artsy, you know? Dino's very artsy-fartsy. It's a lot of shots that are, like, ask me what it means. And it's perfectly reasonable, especially with this kind of source material, but it is kind of pretentious. Comes off as a bit pretentious sometimes.
It's annoying when they spend so much time on this nonsense. And another scene later on, and a few other scenes, even though
they... and a few more after that.
Like, they basically leave everything about the killer and why he's like he is and what he's doing and why he's doing what he's doing. They leave all of that out for some reason.
They hint at it. It's like, well, they're like, hey, he's trying to emulate this Red Dragon thing.
Yeah, but they never find that out. He just shows the picture. And says, my name's the Red Dragon, and he doesn't even have the back tattoo, and they don't, and there's a scene when they're like, oh, hey, there's this, why don't serial killers take trophies? Why, what are his trophies? And they don't go into the fact that he films his frickin' crimes.
Well, yeah, he films the crimes.
They don't even show that.
But he also, like, watches the home movies that the family's made.
And Will get also, when he goes up to the crime scene, he looks at the home movies.
Mm-hmm. Like, he cases them basically through the home films, which is actually pretty smart.
He explores the house, in the their house, touches all their stuff.
he rubs his nose on everything.
Yeah.
He steals the stockings from all the ladies' drawers so he can wear them on his face all the time and intimidate people and ask.
No, I mean Will Graham walks around their house touching everything.
that too, but I also imagine him like being the type that also like steals things just to like mess around with them too, because he is the baby hunter.
when he's watching the home movies, both of the families had a pet, a dog and a cat. The cat was killed, the dog was almost killed but was at the vet. The movie doesn't outright explain it, but he breaks the mirrors, he shoots all the people except for the woman.
Yeah, he shoots, like, literally everybody that's around the woman.
He sets them up. He puts glass in the mirrors in their eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And then does the sexual assault and then the murder with his hands.
Does he outright actually sexually assault them? Because I don't think it mentions any of that.
Yes, he does. They found his saliva on the suction cup. He used the glass cutter to open the door.
Yeah, but that's not sexual assault.
And they found semen samples.
Oh, they did actually get... Okay, I missed that part. But I assumed, but I wasn't sure.
I watched this because movie twice.
Okay, because they do mention that, like they do tempt him by saying, like, yeah, he sexually assaulted a bunch of his victims, but he says, they say in the interview that it was only the male ones. I thought they were just doing that to get his goat.
Well, saying was just
saying that he sexually assaulted them.
Will Graham is later watching the home movies in his hotel room.
Yeah, he got copies of them.
And watching he figured out that, the killer throughout it had, there are no fingerprints because he had gloves on, but they did find blonde hair at the scene. And
and also, yeah, the saliva on the suction cup that he used to cut the glass.
Because he does not care. That, cause...
Yeah, that one he doesn't care.
And they were looking at it, and it's like, that... Watching it, he's like, you found... Wait, they found baby powder on the body.
Mm-hmm.
There was no baby... There was no baby powder in the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my god, he took his gloves off. There's a fingerprint.
Yeah, like, Will actually has the revelation. It's like, why would there be any of that over there? It's like, oh shit, you took them off to touch her. You took the gloves off to touch her, you bastard. I like Will's monologues a lot in this.
I really like Will in this. He's my second favorite Will Graham.
Mm-hmm. He's really good, honestly. I like him a lot in this.
My favorite Will Graham is great. Obviously in the TV show.
Mm-hmm.
He's just
the monologues, though. Like, his monologues, honestly, his talking to the killer without him being around him, like, just when he's alone and stuff. His thought process, his little mannerisms, the fact that, like, he's freaking out trying not to actually become one of these sociopaths in the midst of, you know, being around them all the time and putting himself in the mindset is really, really,
because
like,
that's his entire thing. It's enticing. That's his, how he figures it out, is he knows how to think like one of these people, which is not something you ever want to do.
Yeah, but the actor himself, the way that he portrays that kind of internal turmoil is fantastic.
Yeah, he's great.
He really gives it its own his own go, you know, and it's. He does it perfectly.
We get the internal memo at the, we're at the police station, just giving all the information. Hey, I heard you guys call him the Tooth Fairy. Don't let that get out.
Don't let him get wind of that, because it might provoke him to do some other shit.
No, it's just don't have that out, because the press is gonna have a field day with that name.
Mm-hmm. And they get a hold of it eventually, though.
Obviously. they get the print. And they're running it through with the lab guys.
Yeah, he says, like, yeah, we see, took the gloves off and everything, close their eyes.
Yeah.
And he says, like, take swabs of their eyelids, because he must have opened their eyes before, after they died, or, like, after he shot them, whatever.
And they made a mold of the teeth based on the bite marks on the bodies. And they're big, and they're pointy, and they're really spooky big teeth.
Mm-hmm. They're like, he's got real, really pronounced canines, I think.
And then we meet Freddy Lowndes.
Mm-hmm. He's fucking annoying.
He is a reporter. I use that term loosely. He works, because he works for a tabloid.
Very much so.
He works for a tabloid. I do not consider that actual journalism.
Yeah, it's a freaking scream column. That's basically what he writes.
But the thing is, even if he worked for a legitimate paper, this is a police film. Mm-hmm. And in police movies, lawyers, defense lawyers and reporters are always the worst people, on par with the criminals in those films.
Yeah, and those characters usually get axed off by the killers in some way, shape, or form.
Just like in private detective.
Because they're scumbags.
Just like in private detective movies, the cops are very useless. Like your Lestrades in Sherlock Holmes and such.
True. Honestly, these characters are basically just there to perform a task until they are no longer useful.
He's an asshole. Will Graham asks him how this new guy compares with Dr. Lector. By the way, for some reason, it's spelled not L-E-C-T-E-R. It's spelled L-E-C-K-T-O-R in this movie. I don't know.
Yeah, it's O-R, right?
Lector.
Yeah. In the books.
It's Lector.
Straight up. Yeah, in the books, it's Lector with an E-R.
Yeah, in this, it's Lector.
Like, hang on. I'm looking through my book right now to try to see it.
Yeah, it's Lector.
Like, I'm freaking...
It's one of the... I guess it's just one of the changes they made when they made, like, changing the name to Manhunter.
Yeah, honestly, I wonder why they did it.
Maybe it was a...
It's a weird choice.
Like, I can't even think it's, like, a rights thing, because it was just one book. And
it can't be.
And
it can't be a rights thing.
And didn't matter yet? I don't know. I don't know why they did
this. This got licensed, no?
Yeah, you can't have all the other names. It's weird. It's a weird thing about this movie. But
yeah, honestly, I doubt De Laurentiis wouldn't have
Point is, it. Will Graham slams him into a car's windshield.
Yeah, he freaking, like, judo hip tosses him into a car, and it's the best. This is our hero. He's fucking badass.
Somehow
he slams journos into fucking car windows.
I gotta say, Will Graham, Freddie Lounge rather, takes this surprisingly well because there's no hit piece written about this. He just gets smashed into a car windshield. He's like, yep, I deserve that, and moves on.
Well, kind of like, what's he gonna say? Dear readers, I got slammed into a fucking car windshield today, broke my coccyx, a freaking PI did it to me. This is the guy, you know, the one that caught the Hannibal Lecter? Yeah.
Well, no, it's, he probably, like,
got my ass handed
cop
to me.
Cop assault, FBI agent, but he's not a cop, by the way, he's FBI. Cop assault journalist, mm-hmm. or something like that.
Former cop.
Police.
Former cop.
Well, he's not a cop, he's FBI, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, former FBI, whatever. But I thought it was former.
It'd be written up like, FBI agent with history of mental illness assaults, because Will Graham also was in a psychiatric hospital following his being attacked by Dr. Lecter.
FBI agent fucks my ass till I laugh. Details on page 3.
Oh, when he's going through the houses, by the way, he's speaking notes into a tape recorder.
Yes,
and I gotta say, I've been rewatching Twin Peaks lately, and seeing an FBI agent speak into
Diana.
A tape... No, let me finish. Seeing him speak into a tape recorder and say things that pertain to the case, not just rambling on about pie, Douglas firs, and Tibet, is really strange. Because it's like, oh, he's gonna ramble some nonsense out, because that's what FBI agents do, I guess.
He's actually saying things that pertain to the case.
It's weird that he's doing that.
Yeah, it's like, oh, so he's not just talking about the pie. Instead, he's actually, like, analysis. He's actually doing a proper psychological analysis of this guy.
If you're ever in the neighborhood, the Lamplighter Inn, they've got a cherry pie that'll kill you.
Honestly, that would be kind of fitting in this movie. It would be.
I want to see Dale Cooper go up against Hannibal Lecter.
It would be over in a minute.
I want to see Hannibal...
In a minute, dude.
Dale would say something bizarre and Lecter would be like, yeah, cool, I surrender. I'm out.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, you're the guy coming at me? Okay, I'm gonna stand myself then.
Nah, this is too weird. This is too strange for me.
It's like, oh, you're gonna lock me. Okay, no, you know what? Never mind. I'll let myself in there.
Heck, I think, like, but the other way, I think Bob would possess Lecter, and Bob himself would be horrified by what's in Lecter's head and would leave.
Just freaking out, man.
So.
He goes to see Dr. Lecter after that little run-in with the journalist. And by run-in, I mean running him into a car windshield. He needs to go... Will needs to go see him to get the mindset of the killer back.
And we meet Brian Cox, Dr. Lecter, mm-hmm. with a Chilton who is not as much of an asshole as he usually is in the books, I gotta say.
I love the first thing that he says is like... Huh, that's some interesting aftershave you got there. Is that the one you were wearing when I saw you in court?
That's the same aftershave you wore in court. It's something a child would buy. I'm sure it has a ship on the bottle. Hello, Will.
Yeah. He's not even looking at him. He's, like, facing the wall, like, laying in bed. And then they proceed to talk for a few minutes
help me catch the serial killer. Why? Well, it'll help you prove you're smarter than him, which infers you think you're smarter than me because you caught me.
Mm-hmm.
You're always an animal, Will. I just gave you claws.
I like the other one that he says is like, "Oh, you want the smell of the killer?" Smell yourself.
You want to know why you caught me, Will? It's because we're the same.
Mm-hmm.
You're not so different, you and I.
Give me the case notes. Give me the case notes. And I'll give you it if you agree to help. I'll help if you give me the case notes. And he gives him the case notes and
gives it to him to read. Yeah,
I'll call you to see if you have anything. Do you want to give me a home phone number? No.
I love that one so much.
Do you want to give me a home?
You want me to call? You want me to call you at home? Fucking wow.
And jeez. I love in some of the shots how not like a human, but more like some kind of vampire or orc Brian Cox looks. It's the ears, the way the ears stick out. It's pointed and he's
it's also like the way he like tilts his head around sometimes, also just like the way he's like hunched, like he's also like he's like he's got like the physical posture of like a Nosferatu.
Yeah, he does have a bit of the Orlok about him.
Mm-hmm. He's really
and that like, gives us
chilling to watch.
It gives us three
it's uncanny
Hannibals that are in Marvel characters.
That's true.
Because Brian
Hannibal King.
Because Brian Cox. No, that's not what I mean. Because Brian.
Yeah, I don't. Because
Brian Cox is he played Colonel William Stryker in X-Men United. Anthony Hopkins obviously is the Allfather Odin, and Mads Mikkelsen, who played him in the very good Hannibal TV show, which I recommend everyone check out, was Cassilius in Doctor Strange.
Honestly, really, really heavy ties here.
So Will Graham leaves having a bit of a panic attack and is photographed by Freddie Lowndes coming out of the Baltimore State Hospital for the mentally insane.
Yeah, and he basically puts this in the tabloid, FBI agent fucks my ass, blah, blah, blah.
And then Hannibal gets a phone.
Yeah, he uses a couple of tricks with some chewing gum to hack the phone.
He's just playing 4D chess at this point. He's smarter than everybody.
And honestly, it's like you put Loki in a jail cell. It's like you really expect him not to do some shit in there?
They put Loki in the same jail cell with the same mask, remember?
Honestly. You could give him a freaking walkie-talkie. Somehow he'll find a way to like contact freaking like Armstrong on the moon, you know? Hmm. Like he'll find a way.
Well, of course Loki'd figure out he was raised by Hannibal Lecter. I got to say, as good as Brian Cox, as much as I like Brian Cox as Lecter, Anthony Hopkins is my Hannibal. Just he will always will be.
I think he's everybody's, honestly. Like offense to Cox, but like yeah, honestly Hopkins does a bang up job in opposition.
He was the first one I saw. He's not great in Red Dragon, I'll admit. Brian Cox is better in this version of the story.
Right.
But Silence of the Lambs is the best of the films. So.
And yeah, I'll grant you that.
So
one.
Good in mm-hmm. that movie. Honestly,
I think anybody else would too.
He's so scary without leaving this 8.5 by 11 room. It's
like, honestly, he doesn't have to go fucking anywhere. A character like this can cause just as much shit from a fucking jail cell as if like he had like a freaking like button, like his finger on the button of a nuke.
But he gets Will Graham's home address. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's not great for Will, I'm assuming.
It's really bad for him, honestly. It's painting a target on him and basically anybody he's associated with.
So they investigate some more. They call Freddy in and give him the they find a note from in the newspaper.
Before that, though, actually, even before that, they go check out the house, and he's talking to the realtor about if any single people have been checking out the house since then. He goes to check the backyard, and he scales the tree, and he sees a big symbol carved into the tree.
Yeah, it means the Red Dragon.
It's the Mahjong symbol of a Red Dragon.
It also means egg.
It does?
Well, I found it. I have the same symbol on a tin box of mooncakes.
Okay.
And it's one of those symbols that slight variations can wildly change its meaning.
Oh, it's one of those kind of Chinese symbols, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, I see. One of those kanjis. Okay, so yeah, they go to the house. He sees the kanji thing in the big yard.
Cut the branch with bolt cutters.
Yeah, he cuts the branch with the bolt cutters.
You sat here and watched them all day, didn't you, you son of a bitch?
That's why big yards. That's why the big yard.
Because as Lecter said before, have you ever seen Blood in the Moonlight, Will? It looks quite black. If a killer were nude. And that's like inferring that he's doing this shit naked. That's why he needs the yard is for privacy. Because, there's so many things that they say but don't go into about the killer in this, is he's on a lunar cycle.
Yeah, he only kills on the full moon, apparently.
Because I think the killer confused the dragons with werewolves in this game.
Well, there's already a werewolf killer, and he was in L.A., I think, so.
And then there was another killer who thought he was making zombies. That was a real killer. That was a real serial killer.
There's a lot of weird serial killers out there.
I think all serial killers are weird by definition, because if they weren't weird, they wouldn't be serial killers.
Here's one that's just a gangrel.
Yeah, this guy's a gang. Or is he a Malk?
I think, I think this one here is more of a Malkavian. He's got more of the mannerisms. I would even say Hannibal Lecter's a high level freaking Malkave also.
No, I'd say he's a Ventru.
You think so?
Yeah, I think so. Or a Lasombra.
Maybe Ventru, maybe less Lasombra.
I think though, the Tooth Fairy slash the Red Dragon is more given, like, in the book at least, he's definitely a Toreador.
Okay, I could kind of see that one too.
It's just because a lot of the Thomas Harris killers are Toreadors, because he plays up the artistic serial killer angle a lot.
Of course, yeah, he's got a passion for the artistic. And honestly, like, Lecter himself honestly has that too, but
to a
much weirder degree. Much more gruesome.
Oh, Toreadors played right can be, if as long as you don't play it like Edward Cullen, can be some of the darkest characters in Vampire.
Honestly, Vampire in general, you can just take your character to the nth degree and make them full on beast. But you can take that places. As we said before, like you mentioned, he finds the note corresponding with Lecter in his cell
from Avid Fan.
Yeah, under the alias Avid Fan, and he ends up establishing a connection to personal ads in the newspapers, where they're actually sending the notes back and forth, and how he can how Lecter can get back to him.
And Hannibal has a note ready. They find it. They try to figure out everything they can about the note, which is not a lot. They find Lecter's note on toilet paper. The way to contact is missing, of course.
Yeah, because he burns out the actual personal ad thing on the bog roll, and then blacks it out with a permanent marker.
They send their own message stating that giving them an FBI drop, an FBI drop that Dollarhide can use.
Yeah, but they need to connect that with a book code that is also connected somehow.
It sounds like the Bible, but it's not the Bible. I can't remember what the book is, but the
it was. I think I remember which one.
Okay.
I think it was Judicial Code.
Mm. But they crack it, and the message is it's Will Graham's home address and the words "Save yourself, kill them all."
Yeah.
So obviously, protective custody. Yeah, we're
police moving. Come around.
Yeah, we're moving you.
Yeah, you're under witness protection now.
Why? Oh, I don't know. An angry serial killer knows where you live.
Just stay inside, please. It's for your own good.
And later,
which actually surprisingly works out, because in some movies that doesn't work out.
Later, Will and his son Kevin are in the grocery store, and we get an odd cameo from reminding us we're in the 80s of Mr. T cereal.
Oh, fuck. I wanted to forget about the Mr. T cereal.
A pit of the fool. A pit of the fool who don't make this make me part of a complete breakfast.
You could be somebody too, if you follow Mr. T's big rules.
You too. Don't do school. Drink your drugs. Stay in milk.
Stay in milk.
I'm rearranging them for comedy.
Hello, cocaine. Have a very nice drugs. How is why is day bad?
What bad? Anyway, they also have those snack packs of like Frosted Flakes and those like boxes of tiny boxes of cereal. I remember from when my dad who used to take me camping.
Which coffee do you like? You like this Folgers stuff, huh?
Yeah, it was a weird scene just there for product placement, but it's like
it was really fucking like hammered on the nose.
It's built. It's really there to like him to explain that how his powers work to the kid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but he was saying yeah, I went through a lot of shit when I was in that fucking hospital, kid. Like, don't even ask.
So they send out the fake message. They lie about what they think about the killer to Freddy Lounge to try to trap him.
And it's basically using Will to get his goat and, like, turn himself
first thing into, that happens, into a target. They stake out the drop, and they see a big guy coming to the drop.
Oh yeah, I forgot about that part.
So the cops come out and like, ha, we got you. And it finds out it's not the killer, it's just some black guy.
Just tackles the random black guy.
Out
the guy
for a midnight like jug. And you can tell this is a movie because the cops don't just shoot him anyway.
Uh-huh. Yeah, honestly, in any other film,
I'm saying in reality.
He gets sniped. Yeah. Any other film, and also probably in reality, that black man would have gotten sniped.
But not to get political, though.
Yeah, that's a little bit close to home, I think, given the proper climate of things recently. But the guy's like, what are you standing? What are you walking in slow motion for? Get that guy! He tried to rob me.
Yeah.
After Will just tackles him, basically. Honestly, it was kind of jumping the gun on Will's point of view. I wouldn't have,
about
I wouldn't have
things getting political. I watched that movie, that show, Falcon and the Winter Soldier, and someone complained about people being political in the comments. I'm like, did you watch the show? Because it's really political. Did you watch the show you're commenting about?
Well, I mean, as far as I know, it's got Baron Zemo in it, and honestly, I would be surprised if they didn't touch on even a little bit of the racism that Zemo has done.
Well, he says a song perfectly encapsulates the African American experience, and sounds like he's out of line, but he's right.
Oh wow! Well, yeah, Zemo. Honestly, like I would be really pissed off if they didn't try to make him somewhat relatable.
Well, his thing is, he's not a Nazi. He's, like, violently anti-super soldier in this.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because, well, Red Skull and everything about Red Skull. And it's something about people who are super soldiers are inherently supremacists.
Okay.
Yeah, just watch the show.
Okay, well, honestly, like, I defer people to anybody that actually wants to, like, learn about Baron Zemo, like, what kind of a character Baron Zemo could actually be.
Yep.
I refer them to Deadpool Max. Like, there's a full-on, I think it's maybe, like, second or third issue, something like
second
that.
Second issue. It's not really the best example, because the Max version
I think it is. I think it is.
The Deadpool Max versions of the characters aren't necessarily... Because you know how they did Domino and Cable, right?
Yeah, but those are like played up a little bit more. In my mind, though, I find a character like Zemo is spot on that.
So they catch.
That's what the character should be.
And then they're setting the trap for him with the Inquirer. And like lying about him, making him like insulting him in the press. They take some pictures. And then Freddie Lyons is going to
saying that he's gay, basically.
Yep.
And he's then, like, he, and they basically might as well have just been like, and he's the big gay.
And that he's impotent.
Yeah, exactly. He can't get it up. Also, he banged his mom.
And then they wake up. Then he's going to his car at the Inquirer. Then he gets conked on the head. He wakes up duct taped to a chair.
Do you see?
And we get we see the killer with this nylon sock over his head.
I don't bang my mom. Do you see?
Do you see? He shows him pictures of the family and of William Blake's the Great Red Dragon and the women clothed with the sun.
Here's my big peepee. Do you see?
We cut. They don't put in the tattoo that no, he has on his back. Even and they were going to have it in, like they shot every scene with him shirtless, with both with the tattoo and without it.
Oh yeah.
But the tattoo was on his chest. Even then, I was like, okay.
It's fine. Honestly, that's okay. Honestly, they could have done it either way. It still works fine.
It's like you and the others, you're shivering. That is wrong. You don't owe me fear. You and the others, you owe me
awe. You are, what does he say? You are a slug in the face of the sun.
To me, you're a slug in the sun. You're an ant in the afterlife. You're witnessing a great becoming and you know nothing. You're an ant in the afterbirth.
That whole thing, man. That whole speech.
The thing is that it would have been so simple for the move, for at some point them to explain he's doing this to become. Because he thinks he's turning into the Red Dragon.
Yeah. He's got a power trip.
But they don't explain any of it, so he's just a weirdo in this movie.
Well, they do, like, sort of establish it's like, hey, look, this is his, this is this big Red Dragon thing. Yeah. He's got a superiority complex, and basically, if he can kill enough people, he feels like he can become that.
That's explained by Lector in a later scene, unfortunately, however.
Yeah, exactly. Like, the great becoming is this.
Yeah.
But in terms of, like, the characters actually investigating that and finding out about that kind of thing, it doesn't really matter. They're just interested in stopping this nut job.
Mm. I mean, for the audience. Honestly, I mean, for the audience. I'm saying.
For the audience sake. Yeah. For the audience sake, it should have been better explained. But in terms of the grandiose scheme of it, it's semantics. Because
I like the books, but I shouldn't have to read the book to understand what's going on in the movie.
it's kind of set dressing. It's pushed to the side.
So he has him record a message denouncing what he said. He's not the Tooth Fairy. He's the Red Dragon. And Will Graham, he's going to be merciful to me. Because I did under coercion. But what'll happen to me will be but a fraction of what'll happen to you. And then we cut away, and then Freddie Lounge is duct taped to a wheelchair rolling down a hill on fire.
He's like, yeah, it's like it's showing the security guard inside of the inside of a hospital parking lot.
No, it's the Inquirer, not a hospital.
Oh, okay, it's the Inquirer. Okay, yeah, but the security guard, whatever, he's reading the newspaper and everything.
Paul Blart.
And then he just comes barreling down the fucking ramp on fire in a wheelchair. It's like, holy shit.
Then we actually finally get to see Dollar Hyde as himself. He works developing film.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes, that's how he gets the movies. The whole movies.
And, yeah, it was his job to develop those things.
And he
makes sense.
He talks to his to a coworker, a blind girl whose name I can't remember right now.
Honestly, I didn't really get her name either, but it's very much like what's that one with Robin Williams? What was it called? One Hour Photo?
Maybe.
Wasn't it 1 Hour Photo?
I don't know what that is.
It was the psychological thriller with Robin Williams.
I haven't seen it. I don't know. Sorry.
No, I'm just saying. Like, okay. I think it's very much like that, though, honestly, because he
Reba,
works in the
I
development
think there. Her name is Reba. I don't
know. Yeah.
She's blind. He asks her out. He's like, hey, do you want to ride home? No, I'm okay. Would you like me? Can I drive you home? It would be because I want you. I want to.
Mm-hmm. So he's, they go. Emulating real life.
They go out.
Real life interactions.
They go out on a date. He takes her to see a tiger. Well, see. To,
a Bengal tiger.
To touch a tiger. And
hey, lady, you want to touch a tiger?
So she touches the tiger, I guess. That sounds like a euphemism, but it's not. And I don't know, like, in the book, this is planned out, like, this is led up to. Like, he uh-huh. calls to arrange this beforehand. This isn't the first date. But he just knows a guy who just has an unconscious tiger on.
Yeah, it's like, okay. Sure. And she, like, listens to its heartbeat because she's blind.
She rubs her hands all over, like, around the tiger's face, and, like, this scene made me uncomfortable, because you can train an animal in movies, but this was clearly a real tiger, and just, they were harassing it like you do to a small house cat, and I was worried.
Say molesting?
I was worried the tiger, definitely literally molesting in the book.
Oh, jeez.
But I was worried that the tiger, like, oh, this looks dangerous for the actors.
Man, oh man.
So.
Dino, you genius.
So they go home, they make love.
Yeah.
We leave out the bit where the red dragon part of his personality, because he has multiple personalities, which the movie doesn't go into, wants to kill her.
Well, it's kind of implied. It's like, yeah, he's fighting the urge to just kill her outright. Especially, like, the way he's, like, he's looking at her like he wants to eat her.
Will goes back to see Dr. Lecter. And he's like, do you know why he kills? Why? Well, God likes to kill. People like to kill. I like to kill. You like to kill. God likes to kill. He kills so many people. And if
it's because power.
If you do what God does enough times, you'll become like God is. And that's
powerful.
The last we see a Lecter. And
also we have a scene of his family getting shipped over to Montana to see his wife's grandpa, and he's like, Will is in the mirror, like in the window, with his reflection cast on him, and he's going like, I will find you, god damn it. I will find you, you bastard. I am the baby hunter.
I will find you, and I will kill you.
I'm the baby hunter. I'm Batman.
I have a very particular set of skills.
Finding babies.
Francis Dollarhide goes to pick Reba up again.
Yeah.
And then sees someone else from work with her and thinks they have a thing going. So he rips all the leather off of his car's dashboard, because that's what people do.
Oh, no, he was just pissed because the guy, like, was taking advantage of the blind girl, and she had no idea.
Yeah, but he didn't know that. He thought she was cheating on him, because he's crazy like that.
Yeah, that too.
And so he goes up while Strong As I Am plays, which is a very catchy song. This has a lot of good music, this movie.
Honestly, yes. The soundtrack's freaking solid.
He goes up. He kills
heavy bass and everything. It's good.
He kills the guy with a neck snap, and then he kidnaps.
I thought he shot him.
Maybe he. Anyway, he kills him. Then he goes to the house, and Ribba's like, Francis. No, Francis is gone.
He's gone
forever.
Forever. It's me.
Oh, his teeth are the bitey teeth are fake, by the way.
They are.
We don't go into the fact that, well, yeah, you see him take them out and put them in.
Oh yeah, huh?
It doesn't go into that they were his abusive grandmothers.
Oh god.
There's so much.
Oh my fuck.
Well, it was her fake teeth.
Yeah, I know, but I remember seeing this in The Wire. Oh yeah. My god, this goes full on. Like, The Wire probably got this shit from that.
Yeah,
oh,
probably.
Wow. Holy fuck.
So he takes
oh
her,
my god, McNulty.
He takes her back to his house, and then, loudly plays "In the Garden of Eden" by Iron Butterfly. And she's annoyed because she can't hear him.
Yeah, he like basically full blasts the music so she can't hear him walking around.
And then the cops are coming and he gets a shotgun.
Yeah.
But and, we see Will running.
Runs up in the place. He's like, he gets his gun already while they're in the cop car. And what was it? Jack tells him like, hey, you better not go ahead of us. Like, wait for backup. He's just getting his gun ready. Fucking clicks well, like, that thing Will, closed. Will's and watch- just busts up in there.
Will's walking by the house and he looks up. When he hears the music, he's like, wait, hold on. That sounds like rock and or roll music. And during the organ breakdown, he slow-mo, because Inagata De Vida is an obscenely long song. It's 17 minutes. And he crashes through the window. And then they fight. Dollarhide kills a few cops. Will kills Dollarhide. Mm-hmm. And then he's on a beach with his family, and then they freeze frame. And we get heartbeat, heartbeat. Listen to a heartbeat. Mm-hmm.
It's pretty good. Honestly, like that last song is like it's a bit much.
Well, but,
like
any song is a bit much if it's played over an eighties freeze frame.
I guess, yeah. But I mean, the song that he was, that they were playing while he busts up into the window like a fucking badass
In a Garden of Eden, baby. Yeah, it's the best part.
Yeah, it's the best part. I love
you. Have you listened to that whole song?
Yeah, I've heard it before,
yeah. It's really long. 17 minutes.
It gets stuck in your head, though.
Yeah, I know that. Mm-hmm. And yet, what did you think really of does. The first Hannibal Lecter movie ever made?
I enjoyed The Manhunter. Mm. This movie's fucking great. I like it. It's kick ass. It's got a really good soundtrack. They could have done with a bit more explanation, but also at the same time a little bit less. Mm. But the characters are good. The actors are really good in it.
But it's clear from the title that this is not about Dollarhide. This is a.
This is about
Will Graham.
Him.
He is the
this
man.
This is Will.
Like, the trailer makes it perfectly clear. He's the man. He is the Manhunter.
He is indeed the baby hunter.
Are we going...
he hunts the shit out some babies.
Now, the question y'all are probably asking yourselves right now, are we going to look at the other Hannibal movies?
The answer is...
probably.
Will become a killer as much as everybody else is?
No. He's not coming back.
Isn't he?
No, never.
Well, damn. I guess we're not going to watch the other movies then, because he's the best part of them.
But we will eventually watch them some Halloween in the future. So look forward to that, guys.
Yeah, maybe eventually we'll get back to the adventures of the fava beans and the nice Chiantis. Until then,
Dina De Laurentiis,
I give this movie.
I gotta say,
what do you give this movie
about it, Dina? What? I'm gonna give my review of it right now. Dina De Laurentiis based a movie on a book I was in. He did not cast me as my character, so I ate his liver with some fava beans and a nice Chianti.
That's your review?
That's my review.
Okay. I give this 10 packs of Folgers out of...
Oh, I'm also going to give it a box of Mr. T cereal.
Sure, you do that. Okay. So, I think we can call it there.
No. First, next week.
Next week.
Next week.
Next, we're ready to party.
We're gonna take a look at a longish running series. Have a party. We're not watching. No, it's not Predator.
We're gonna party till our blood runs blue.
Yep. So I'll see you then.
Later, guys.
Peace.
Peace.